I'm Scott Walker, and this is Walks on the Wild Side. In this video, I'm going to show you how I get my photos of waders. Welcome back to Walks on the Wild Side, the channel where I help you capture the beauty of nature through your lens. Today I'm out at the Wash, which, if you don't know, is a massive estuary with multiple rivers that flow to the North Sea. It's something like 150,000 acres and it separates Norfolk from Lincolnshire. It's made up of mud flats such as those behind me and water marshes, which are home to countless birds, and it's one of the best places in the country to photograph waders. So I'm going to start out with some portrait shots, and this follows a very similar technique to that used in a previous video of mine on photographing waterfowl. So if you've not seen that before, please take a look. I'll link it in the card above and the description below. But for now, let's get down to water level and we'll get taking some portraits of waders. So camper mat, keep you dry and relatively comfortable, or at least a little bit less uncomfortable on these rocks. And as you walk down to the edge of these mud flats or water, you'll find that the birds will probably fly off, but just wait here a while and you'll be amazed at how quickly they come back to you. When you're down low, they're really trusting of you and you'll get them coming close. So it just requires a little bit of patience. Now, to get that nice, smooth, blurred out effect leading up to the bird, you just want to make sure that you're as low as possible. For the larger birds, you can probably get away with quite a slow shutter speed, something like 1/200th of a second, but these tiny waders, they can move really fast. So I think you probably want to be bumping up your shutter speed a little bit, maybe 1/600th or 1/800th of a second, because they can move their heads incredibly fast and run across this mud at quite a rate. That was great. I got some really nice shots that I'm happy with. But now let's rewind a few hours to first thing this morning when I came here to photograph one of nature's spectacles. As the Wash fills up and the tide comes in, the high tide brings all of these birds flocking inland as they escape from the rising water. And I came here to photograph this mass of birds in flight. So I'm here first thing in the morning, it's just after sunrise, there's about 3 hours till high tide, and today's high tide is what's called a spring tide, even though it's late summer, but that just means it's the highest of high tides, and the water will come in from a few miles away, right up to where I'm standing now, and that will push the birds inland, and as they come off the water, they may fly together and make a huge cloud of birds, or they may take off in fits and starts and make shapes in the air like a starling murmuration almost. And we'll see these clouds made up of knots and dunlin and oyster catchers. So it should be quite a spectacle. The first birds that come into land are some of our large waders, and they line up against the advancing tide. These are our mostly brown waders. and there are thousands of them. It's estimated that at this time of year, there are around 250,000 birds here. Next up are some of our medium-sized birds, the oyster catchers, and they also form lines, but away from the larger waders, and they keep coming and coming, more and more of them all the time, forming and joining these remarkably straight lines, almost like military lineups. And so we start to get two very distinct lines of birds, one brown and one black and white. Meanwhile, our small waders, the dunlins, sanderlings and ring plovers, take advantage of the remaining mud to get food whilst they still can, before it gets covered in the sea or taken over by the large birds. As the sea continues to advance and the area of available mud gets smaller and smaller, our medium and large waders start marching inland, trooping ever more forward, taking over the space that our small birds are currently enjoying. Birds continue to flock inwards towards this ever-decreasing patch of mud. And every time I've observed these super high tides, it's always the same behaviour. The brown waders separated from the black and white oyster catchers, separated from our small birds. And what a sight it is to see so many thousands of birds crammed into such a tight space in such an orderly way. These birds can be unpredictable in the amount of time it takes them to get up into the air, if they even go into the air at all. Sometimes it can happen quickly. For me, on this day, I was waiting about 4 hours. So in the meantime, it's important to tell the story that's unveiling before your eyes. And these shots show those lineups of birds separated on the remaining mud. During this time, I also saw a visit from a marsh harrier, but the marsh harrier is too slow to scare these birds. Any of them can easily outfly him. And a great white egret came to the edge of the mudflats to observe this mass of birds. Both the egret and the marsh harrier were too far away to get a decent photo of them. But you can use a subject like this as a point of difference in your photos. So what do I mean by a point of difference? Well, it's something that stands out against the rest of the crowd. And in this case, there are thousands of waders in this picture, but there's only one great white egret. And even though it's small, it helps put the rest of the scene into perspective. And there are other ways to use a point of difference too. You may get flybys of other birds. In this case, there's a shell duck soaring high in the sky, and behind him you can see the blurred out sea, mud flats, and that row of oyster catchers. But eventually, they did take to the sky en masse. When the birds first take off, you can sometimes photograph them as one big wall of birds. And this is okay, but a much better way to photograph them is to look for that point of difference. And that's what I've done here. So we can see a curlew flying in front of that wall of birds. And the curlew provides us an opportunity for something to focus on. Whilst we still see the chaos in the background, our eye can come to rest on the curlew. And as the final birds took off to join the others in the sky, I knew that I'd be in for a treat. And it's always fun to look back on these photos and come up with names for the shapes that you see in the sky. So see if you agree with the shapes I've found. My number one tip for you for photographing these large clouds of birds is to get them in the landscape. You've got to remember that your viewer wasn't there And so you need to give them a frame of reference to understand the size of these clouds. And in these photos, you can see the sea, the far coastline, and some trees on the coastline. And it helps your viewer to understand the scale of this.
As the sea recedes and starts to reveal the mudflats again, I'm going to spend a little bit of time here on my fishing stool, focusing along the coastline to get some action shots. It'll probably be mostly dunlin because the larger birds will go further out to sea.
We're now talking about getting photos of groups of small wading birds in flight, and here is a basic example. This, though, can take some practice if you're new to this type of photography. Because the birds are so small, you need to be really careful to make sure that one of your focusing points follows at least one of the birds as you pan around with your camera. But for more advanced photographers, you should start to be aware of things that are in the background or the foreground. So it could be boats on the horizon, or people or objects that are along the coast. And this again will help put things into perspective for your viewer and make a much nicer photo.
So I've had a great day out here on the Wash. I'm really pleased with some of the shots that I've got. And if you're looking to do the same, I would recommend, if you've never done it before, to think about starting at either Snettisham RSPB Nature Reserve or the Wash National Nature Reserve. There are some other great places around the Wash that are a little quieter than those, but these are really great places to start with. I'm hoping to get back to the Wash later on this month or maybe next month to a place that's much more quiet and relatively unknown. So if you want to see that video, please subscribe so that you get notified when that comes out. If you've enjoyed today's video, please give it a thumbs up, really appreciate that. And I'm always happy to answer any questions that you've got, so please ask those in the comments section below. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.